Welcome to Drawing from the Well, the preaching ministry of Rehoboth Baptist Church with Senior Pastor Alan Stewart. We trust you'll be blessed and find faith, hope, and comfort as we draw from the principles and promises of the Word of God together.
I've had a dollar to my name. I've had friends that walked away. And I've even lost myself a time or two. There were bridges crossed and burned. And through all the wreckage I have learned, there is one thing that I can never lose. If I've got Jesus, I've got all that I could ever need. Take the world away from me, and I'll be okay. If I've got Jesus, there's a hope that's living deep inside, a joy that I could never hide, and a safe place to fall. If I've got Jesus, I've got it all. I've seen weakness turn to strength. I've seen failures met with grace. And it's not for what I've done, it's Christ in me. A miracle I can't explain. Oh, he's given me his name. I'm the richest man that I could ever be. If I've got Jesus, I've got all that I could ever need. Take the world away from me, and I'll be okay. If I've got Jesus, there's a hope that's living deep inside. A joy that I could never hide, a safe place to fall. If I've got Jesus, I've got it all. Oh, someday that trumpet's gonna sound, and the King of Heaven will ride upon a cloud coming down. I'll hit my knees, oh Lord, then sings my soul. I'm going home. If I've got Jesus, I've got all that I could ever need. Take the world away from me, and I'll be okay. If I've got Jesus, there's a hope that's living deep inside, a joy that I could never hide, a safe place to fall. If I've got Jesus, I've got it all. If If I got Jesus, I've got it all.
Amen. What a great way to begin our service this morning. If you've got Jesus, you've got it all. Amen. Again, it is great to see each of you here this morning. Hope you've had a good week. And I pray that the Spirit of God will speak to all of us loud and clear this morning. He will bring encouragement to our heart and our life. And I want to take a moment to welcome our first-time guest who may be here with us today. Thank you so much for coming and being part of our worship service. May you find our fellowship warm and inviting. And Rehoboth family, look around you. Look down the rows where you're at. Spot our visitors. Would you take the time to warmly welcome and greet them here today before they leave this place? Let them know they are welcome. Just one quick announcement. I made this a couple of weeks ago. I want to make it a few more times till we get there. But we are 4 weeks away from beginning a new Sunday school program as we're going to expand out into some age-appropriate classes. And they're going to put that up on the screen there so you can see the teachers that are going to be in the different classes. We'll talk more about where those classes are going to be in the weeks to come. This will begin the Sunday after Easter. That is April the 7th that we'll begin all these new classes. And this coming Wednesday night, we need to have a very short, brief, special meeting in a business meeting just to approve getting one of those rooms renovated that is going to be our old balcony in the old sanctuary. So we'll just have to cover that very quickly Wednesday night. But I'm excited to see that we've got more classes available for those age-appropriate groups. People have been wanting that. Now that we've got this far beyond COVID, people feel comfortable getting back into classrooms again. And so it's kind of getting us back to some kind of normalcy. So ready to do that. Would you join me this morning in a word of prayer? Father, I pause and I pray that in this service, all of our attention would be focused solely on you. That somehow the cares, the burdens, all the things that could be a distraction would not be there in our minds today. I pray that you would give us clarity in your word, and may you speak something to all of us that will be a blessing. Fill this place with your presence. May you touch every heart, every life that is here with a touch of grace. So many have come with so many different needs today. But Father, it's amazing how in your presence all things are met. So this morning, would you do that in this place? Touch every life. Give us what we need before we leave this place today. And I ask it all in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good morning. As we stand together, children, you may be dismissed and go to children's church. And as they leave, let's read scripture together. Psalm 147, in a good loud voice, praise the Lord. How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant and fitting to praise Him. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. His understanding has no limit. Sing to the Lord with grateful praise. Make music to our God and praise His name.
With a I looked, and there before me was a throne in heaven, with someone sitting on it. From the throne came flashes of lightning, rumblings, and peals of thunder. Before the throne, there was a sea of glass, like crystal. Then I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne, a scroll with writing on both sides, and sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming in a loud voice, "Who is worthy to break the seals and open the scroll?" But no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth could open the scroll or even look inside it. I wept and wept because no one was found who was worthy to open the scroll. Then one of the elders said to me, "Do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has triumphed. He is able to open the scroll and its seven seals." Then I saw a lamb, looking as if it had been slain, standing at the center of the throne, encircled by the four living creatures and the elders. He went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who sat on the throne. And when he had taken it, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb. And they sang a new song, saying, "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain. And with your blood you purchased for God persons from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom of priests for our God, and they will reign on the earth." Then I looked and heard the voice of millions of angels. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders, and they sang in a mighty chorus, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise." And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them saying, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb, be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever."
Find the book of Genesis, the very first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 28. I'm going to continue in a series that I'll wrap up the week before Easter, Glimpses of Glory. And I hope and pray that the Lord is using this series to give some comfort, encouragement to your heart. Because again, all of us who are here, all of those who are listening on live stream, we all have family and friends who are already on the other side. And the one thing you discover as you begin to age and you accumulate some years, you reach a time and a point where there are more that are over there than are over here. And so I pray that God is using this series to be a blessing to you. Genesis chapter 28 this morning, let's begin reading in verse 10. "Now Jacob went out from Beersheba and went toward Haran. So he came to a certain place and stayed there all night because the sun had set. He took one of the stones of that place and put it at his head, and he lay down in that place to sleep. Then he dreamed, and behold, a ladder was set up on the earth, and its top reached to heaven. And there
the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, 'I am the Lord God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give to you and your descendants. Also, your descendants shall be as the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad to the west and the east, to the north and to the south. And in you and in your seed, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Behold, I am with you, and will keep you wherever you go, and will bring you back to this land. For I will not leave you until I have done what I have spoken to you. Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place! There is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. John Patton was a missionary to the New Hebrides Islands. One night, the story goes that natives surrounded the mission station, intent on burning out the Pattons, and when they came out of their house, they were going to kill them. Patton and his wife prayed during this terror-filled night that God would somehow be able to deliver them. As daylight broke, they were amazed to see all of their attackers had departed. A year later, the chief of the tribe was converted to Jesus Christ. Remembering what happened on that terror-filled night, Patton asked the chief, what was it that kept his men from burning down the house and killing both of them? The chief said in surprise, who were all of those men there with you on that night? Patton knew that there was no men who were present, but the chief said that they were afraid to attack because they had seen hundreds of big men in shining garments with drawn swords in their hands circling the mission statement. Had God sent a legion of angels to protect His servants whose lives were being endangered? Throughout Christian history, the number one theme of artists and painters and sculptures that depict the story of the Bible has been the cross. A close second has been that of angels. Probably no major theological issue has received as much attention in modern times than the doctrine of angels. We see it from best-selling books to TV shows to restaurant conversations to university seminars. There is a burst of curiosity regarding angels. So, could more attention to angels today actually be God's plan for His people at this time and moment in history? Is it a signal that we're on the threshold of something bigger on God's timetable for the world? Jesus told us about such an event. Listen to it in Matthew 16 and verse 27. For the Son of Man will come in the glory of His Father and His angels. With that thought in your mind this morning, I want to speak to you on this subject, angels among us. In this passage, we find Jacob's first encounter with God. He is on a 500-mile journey to his uncle's house. He is in search of a bride. But at the same time, he is running to avoid his brother that he fears is going to pursue him and kill him. When he decides to spend the night here at Bethel, he had no idea that on this night, God was going to meet him in a very special way. As he lay down to sleep, we're told that he could see then angels in a dream who were going up and down a ladder. Now, this word ladder in the Old Testament Hebrew is more literally a staircase. You'll find that Jesus gave a very similar description of this dream when he was speaking in his first encounter with Nathanael in the New Testament. In John 1 and verse 51, Jesus said to him, most assuredly, I say to you, hereafter you shall see heaven open, and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. You can be sure this morning that angels are very important to the Lord. I was amazed when I began to break down and separate this subject in the Word of God to discover there are over 300 references to angels in the Bible, and you find those in over 34 books of the Bible. But yet still today, there is much mystery, misinformation about angels. So exactly what are angels? Angels are spiritual beings created by God for the purpose of serving Him. Jesus referred to them over and over as holy angels because they have remained obedient to God and they carry out His will. But as you ponder this subject of angels in the Bible, you quickly lock in on two things: majesty and awe. The majesty is always there in who they are, and this awe is constantly inspired in the people who are exposed to them. When you study the subject of angels in the Word of God, you'll find angels can be as winsome as serving baked bread to Elijah or helping Daniel simply get back up on his feet. But you'll also find on the other side, angels can be as powerful as helping Peter to escape a maximum security prison or as repellent as a flaming sword keeping the Egyptian army at bay. Friends, if there was ever a time when people needed special power and the blessings of heaven in their lives, that time is now. We live in some very troubling times, politically, socially, and economically. But as believers, we can look up, take courage, because angels are nearer than you think. For after all, we're told in Psalm 91 and verse 11, God will give His angels orders concerning you to protect you in all of your ways. So this morning, I want us to focus in on what God has told us about angels. First thing I want you to notice is the mystery of angels. Again, He says in verse 12, then He dreamed, and behold, a ladder was set up on the earth, and its top reached to the heaven, and there the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. Now, there are some people who just overestimate angels and their importance. But then there are others on the other side who deny the very existence of angels. They'll say something like this: listen, Pastor, it's nothing but mythology. Angels are invisible. And so what they believe is invisible means it must not be real. But how many of you know this morning it's a tragic mistake to assume that something that is not visible to the naked eye is not real? I mean, you think about this morning. Electricity is invisible. But I challenge you. Go stick your finger in a socket and you will discover the reality of electricity. And then there are germs, genes, chromosomes. Many of the foundations of science that are invisible to the naked eye, but they are incredibly real. And so it is with angels. Scripture speaks very clearly of angels. Again, they are created beings. Paul gives us a very clear explanation in Colossians 1 and verse 16. For by Him all things were created that are in the heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through Him and for Him. But exactly when did God create angels? Well, God tells Job that angels were already on the scene to celebrate when He created the earth. You may recall in a conversation, God had asked a very probing question. Where were you, Job, when I laid the foundations of the earth? Of course, Job wasn't there. And for his benefit then, God adds some details of what that groundbreaking moment was like in Job 38 and verse 7. While the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy. Job wasn't there, you and I weren't there when the earth was formed, but the angels were. And they were having a joyful time when God was creating this world. That brings up another question. How many angels are there in existence? Well, there is no precise count that is given to us in Scripture, but there is plenty of evidence that they make up a mighty multitude. David told us in Psalm 68 and verse 17 that there were thousands upon thousands. Then John looked around the throne and saw in Revelation 5 and verse 11, 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands. You may recall on that dark night of agony in Gethsemane as Jesus prayed, an angel came and ministered to him. He had to stop his disciples from wanting to fight this army of soldiers. And he says to them in Matthew 26 and verse 53, "Do you think that I cannot now pray to my Father, and he will provide me with more than 12 legions of demons?" The total of angels, the total host that Jesus brings to mind here is 144,000 angels. That's 12,000 bodyguards for every one of the 12 disciples. Moses then said in Deuteronomy 33 and verse 2 that there were 10,000 angels that came down on Mount Sinai to confirm the presence of God when he gave the law unto Moses. But in a very majestic description, we're told in Hebrews 12 and verse 22, the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels. And using all of these descriptions of the numbers, the Bible is simply telling us it is a host of angels that more than any of us could ever look at and get an adequate count of. There's a lot of angels. Secondly, I want you to see the makeup of angels. Again, as he's in this dream, he says in verse 12, a ladder was set up on the earth. The top reached to heaven. And there the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. Angels like wind and fire are servants of God. And what he's seeing here is they are constantly going back and forth doing God's will. So this tells us something very important. Angels have a personality. You see, there are three things that you've got to have in order to have a personality. Number one, you have to have intellect. That is, you've got to know some things. You have to accumulate some knowledge. Angels know some things. In many ways, their intellect is greater than ours because they've been around a lot longer period of time, and they have accumulated a certain amount of knowledge. In fact, Peter tells us that in the story of Christ and his redemption and the salvation that he offers in 1 Peter 1 and verse 12, these are things which angels desire to look into. It's hard for them to understand this plan and how it works out, but in their intellect, they are watching and gathering information. Secondly, to have a personality, you've got to have emotion. Angels express joy. In fact, we're told in Luke 15 and verse 10, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. A third thing you've got to have a personality, you must have a will. God made angels just like humans with the freedom of choice. We see this when Lucifer, the chief angel of Isaiah 14, made a choice. And he suffered the consequences of that choice. The Bible tells us in Revelation 12 and verse 4 that as he falls, a third of the angels of heaven disobeyed with him, and they fell from their holy position. And so now they stand in active opposition to the work and the plan of God. And by the way, that decision is an irrevocable decision. There is no demon who will ever be redeemed to be an angel again. It is a once forever decision that is made. The third thing I want you to see, and that is the manifestation of angels. Again, he's minding his own business. He lays down to go to sleep. Verse 12, and then he dreams. And in that dream, he saw a ladder, and there the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. It seems from the description here and in other passages, angels have the ability to change their appearance and also to shuttle in a flash from the capital glory of heaven to earth and back again. However, our eyes are not constructed to see them ordinarily, any more than we can see the dimensions of a nuclear field. And yet angels may become visible by their own choice. Let me give you a couple of examples. You may remember in the Old Testament when Balaam was riding his donkey and he was heading out in disobedience. The Bible tells us the eyes of the donkey were opened and he saw the angel with a sword that was drawn. And the donkey turned aside to avoid the angel. Balaam begins to beat the donkey. Then here's what we're told in Numbers 22 and verse 31. Then the Lord opened Balaam's eyes and he saw the angel of the Lord standing in the way and his drawn sword in his hand. And then in the 13th chapter of Hebrews, as it opens, we encounter a series of commands. Among them in verse 2, do not forget to entertain strangers, for by doing some have unwittingly entertained angels. Do you remember the stories in the Old Testament about Abraham and Sarah and others who entertained people only to find out later they were angels in disguise? Now I want you to think about this morning. If we were to take that seriously, do you not think it would revolutionize our church and every church's friendliness? I mean, think of it this way. That new face that you may greet next Sunday could be one of the cherubim and seraphim. Now, you're probably thinking about the person sitting right beside you today. You're saying, Pastor, they're no angel. I know them. But listen to me. Again, we're told in the Word of God, some people have entertained strangers to only discover they were entertaining angels. Sometimes the appearance of angels and the form they take is unbelievable. And then other times it is downright frightening. That's why you'll find many times in the Word of God that when an angel did show up, they always had to start with these words, "Fear not." In fact, a few times when people recognized it was a heavenly visitor, they would fall down and begin to worship. When John was taken on the guided tour of heaven by an angel, he was struck with such awe that he too fell down and began to worship. But listen to what the angel said in Revelation 22 and verse 9. See that you do not do that. Then notice the last words of the verse, worship God. One thing you can be sure today, angels never draw attention to themselves, but they ascribe glory to God alone. A fourth thing I want you to see, and that is the mission of angels. Again, here we're told that these angels of God were ascending and descending on this ladder. So just why would God create these troops of heavenly beings when He really doesn't need them? I mean, God is almighty. He is all-powerful. Well, the answer to that question is for the same reason you and I were born and were kept alive. It's all wrapped up in the purpose and the pleasure of God. Let me break it down for you this morning. Three areas of mission for angels. First of all, angels worship. Angels live in the presence of God, and so they stay focused on God every moment. And this is where they get their majesty and their all. Some of the richest scenes of heavenly worship in all the Bible are found in the book of Revelation. Here the angelic beings demonstrate their reverence for God, and they make a point of doing it over and over and over again. John tells us in Revelation 4 and verse 8, they do not rest day or night, saying, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. A chapter later in chapter 5 and verse 11, John said, he heard the voice of many angels around the throne as they worshiped. Then after six of the seals on the scroll have been opened in Revelation 7 and verse 11, he says, all the angels stood around the throne and the elders and the four living creatures and fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God. Now, from all that we gather in Scripture, angels are right now worshiping. And I want you to think of this. If these beings, as awesome as they are, cry out in praise day and night to God, how much more should you and I be doing that in our lives? Then secondly, angels war. A term that you find over and over in Scripture that is used of angels in a collective sense is the word host. You'll find it in the Old Testament over and over again. It implies organization and order among angels, especially in the sense of being organized for battle. Here's how the prophet Micaiah stated it before King Ahab in 2 Chronicles 18 and verse 18. I saw the Lord sitting on his throne, and all the host of heaven standing on his right hand and his left. A big part of angel work and their activity is spiritual warfare. We're told a story of Elisha and his servant being surrounded by the Syrian army. The servant looks out and he's terrified. But Elisha looks out the window and he doesn't see the same thing. He tells his servant, don't fear. And then he prays and asks God to do something. We're told then in 2 Kings 6 and verse 17, and the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. In the book of Revelation, we read of a time when all the armies of the world are going to gather together against God in the battle of Armageddon. Paul tells us what happens in 2 Thessalonians 1 and verse 7. When the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels. Not only do they worship, not only do they war, but angels watch. That is, they observe us. Paul mentions how the apostles were on display with a heavenly audience in 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 9 as a spectacle to the world, both to angels and to men. Later, he gives these solemn instructions to young Timothy, 1 Timothy 5 and verse 21, in the sight of God and Christ Jesus and the elect angels. Don't miss this. God is showing the angels something when he works through our lives. God wants the angels to see his wisdom at work in a miraculous way through the saving gospel of Jesus Christ. Angels were already peering through the windows of heaven when Jesus was walking among us. Paul confirms they had their eyes glued on the Word who became flesh. When he listed the wonders of Christ, he included in 1 Timothy 3 and verse 16 that he was seen by angels. Angels are watching. They're observing. A last thing today, I want you to see the ministry of angels. He's had the dream. There's the ladder. Angels ascending and descending. Then verse 13. And behold, the Lord stood above it. The Bible tells us that Jesus is at the right hand of the Father, interceding for us right now. Now we add to that this image of angels coming from and going to the presence of the Lord. This imagery gives us some idea of their ministry in response to the prayers of Jesus. And we find confirmation of this in Hebrews 1 and verse 14. Are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for those who will inherit salvation? Now I want you to think of it. Multitudes of angels performing the commands of heaven.
So for just a moment as we close, I want you to think about some things that angels do in ministry to us. Number one, angels deliver God's messages. Throughout the Bible, you'll find angels involved in communicating God's truth or message as they were given direction. And this is very much in keeping with the basic meaning of the word angel. In both Old Testament and New Testament, the word angel literally means a messenger. In a number of passages of Scripture, angels appeared to give a very important announcement. For instance, Gabriel announced the birth of John the Baptist. Gabriel announced the birth of Jesus Christ. Gabriel brought an answer in the Old Testament to Daniel in Daniel 10 and verse 12. Your words were heard, and I have come in response to your words. Angels deliver God's messages. Number two, angels give us protection. I would say no other aspect of their ministry is more talked about than this idea of a guardian angel. Over the years, I have often been asked, Pastor, do you think that we all have a guardian angel? As far as I can tell and determine, there are a few verses in the Bible that might indicate that we might have guardian angels in the world today. Let me share them with you. Psalm 34 and verse 7. The angel of the Lord encamps all around those who fear Him and delivers them. We see that idea when angels come and took Lot by the hand, led him out of Sodom. We see it pictured when Peter was led out of the prison. We see it when Daniel was in the lion's den and an angel came and gave those lions lockjaw. Then in Matthew 18 and verse 10, listen to Jesus' words. Take heed that you do not despise one of these little ones. For I say to you that in heaven, their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven. Apparently, some of God's angels are assigned and stand ready before the Father to respond instantly to His command for protection and care over these children. Jesus here calls these particular angels their angels. Now, we can't absolute with certainty know whether or not every believer's got a guardian angel, but we can gather from God's word that His angels care about us. They intervene in our lives as they are called by God. And so that's a wonderful thought for us to have in mind. Third thing, angels provide for us. Now we have the Holy Spirit indwelling us, ministering to our spiritual needs. But we have angels around us who often take care of our physical needs. We see over and over the details of how the life of Jesus was intertwined with the ministry of angels. You may recall after His wilderness temptation, Matthew 4 and verse 11, we're told, behold, angels came and ministered to Him. By the way, this word ministered is where we get our English word deacon from. They came and they served as deacons unto Jesus. And then after the grueling experience of Gethsemane, where His sweat became as great drops of blood, Luke 22 and verse 43, an angel appeared to Him from heaven, strengthening Him. You see, angels not only provide assistance, but they also can provide some encouragement. Angels show a great love for believers, especially knowing that Jesus was willing to leave heaven and die for them. An angel addressed Daniel this way in Daniel 10 and verse 11. O Daniel, a man greatly beloved. An angel then enlightened Gideon in Judges 6 and verse 12. The Lord is with you, you mighty man of valor. They provide assistance, but they provide encouragement. Fourthly, angels accompany us at death. I'm not going to say a lot about this because I've already talked about it in another message. But Jesus told us that when the beggar Lazarus died, Luke 16 and verse 22, he was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. When any believer passes from this life to the next, God assigns angels who carry us into his presence. Jesus himself said in John 5 and verse 24 that if we hear his word, believe on him who sent him, we'll not be under condemnation, not in judgment, but is passed from death into life. This word pass literally means to change places, to move from one place to another. But the Greek root word adds this, to be accompanied from one place to another. God sends his heavenly escorts to lead us home so that we don't have to make that journey alone. A last thing, angels rejoice at our salvation. Now, I've already given you the verse in Luke that tells you this, but we've got a clear image of it and the deepest reason of their elation. John tells us in Revelation 5 and verse 12, he heard angels say with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain." You see, angels cannot fully imagine what it's like to be lost and the need for redemption. But it does set off a celebration in heaven whenever someone on earth recognizes who Jesus is, what he has done, and their need for him as a Savior. Won't it be thrilling one day to meet Gabriel and Michael, the angel that was there in Daniel's lion's den, maybe the one who rolled away the stone from Jesus' tomb? Well, I want you to think about this. Those same angels are carrying their invisible ministry even to us still today right here on earth. Let me close with this story today. Dr. Abby Goodrich was an American missionary in China. One day during the Boxer Rebellion, she was on the lookout wall in Peking. She saw the enemy approaching within seconds of achieving its objective. When suddenly the entire army turned and fled in confusion. Several of those who fled were captured. And when they were asked why they ran away, they said, "We saw the walls suddenly swarming with soldiers, dressed in white with their swords drawn. And we cried out, 'The gods have come down to fight for the foreigners.' We were filled with fear and ran away." Ladies and gentlemen, I can't stand here today and tell you I know everything about angels. But I know this, God's given us enough imagery in his word to know it's not mythology. You may be surprised how many times in your own life an angel, you were in their presence. They protected you from great harm. They stood in the way for you going out away from the presence and will of God in your life. And maybe today, you may be surprised to know that right here in this very room, there could be an angel right here among us. Would you join me in a word of prayer today? As they're coming with a song of invitation, we prepare our hearts. God does so many things for us. And one of those things that we don't think very much about is he gives his angels charge and commands regarding our life. May we today be sensitive to God and what he is saying to us in this place. Our altars are going to be open. Maybe there's a burden that you're carrying today and you just want to bring it to Jesus. Whatever it is that he's speaking to you, just be obedient to him. Would you come? Spirit of God, in this invitation, it's my prayer that you would speak to hearts all over the room. Give encouragement where discouragement is abounding. Give love where uncertainty has overwhelmed. May you give a touch of grace to every person today, and I ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. As we stand and sing, our altar's open. Would you come today?
Only you are holy. Only you are worthy. Only you are wonderful. For there's no one else like you. Who is faithful, ever true? All my love, my heart, my life is a testimony. Only faithful, ever true. All my love, my heart, my life is a testimony. Only only you. there's no one else like you, who is faithful, ever true. All my heart, my life is a testimony. Only Jesus, draw me close, closer, Lord, to you, and let the world around me fade away. Jesus, draw me close, closer, Lord, to you, for I desire to worship and obey.
I've got several presentations to make to you today, and you know, one of the things that happens when you get older is you don't remember things, even though it just happened 2 minutes ago. So there's a lot of names I'm going to have to try to remember, and I hope I do this right today. First of all, this is Steve Cottrell. If you'll come on up front, I want you to know these folks are going to be incredibly thrilled to know he's coming today to make public his profession of faith in Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. And we are proud of you. This is the greatest decision that you will make in your life. And so we'll talk a little more about it and about baptism. And whenever you're ready for that, we'll get that all set up. This is Kim Donaldson. Oh, I got this right. If you'll come and stand here, Kim. Kim is coming with her statement of faith in Jesus Christ. She's going to follow in believer's baptism. But she would like to be a member of our church. And what is the desire of our church today? Motion is made. Do I hear a second? All in favor, would you say praise the Lord? I'll just keep moving down. This is the Lewis family. And they are coming from a church of light faith, wanting to unite with our church family. What is the desire of our church today? Motion is made. Do I hear a second? All in favor, would you say praise the Lord? And then we've got one, the Dye family. They're going to come. I'm going to go ahead and move on out of the way. I don't know if our camera can catch all these folks. But this is the Dye family. They are too coming from a church of like faith, wanting to unite with our church family. What is the desire of our church? Motion is made. Do I hear a second today? All in favor, would you say praise the Lord? This has been a great day. I'm going to say to all of you, as I say to anyone and everyone who comes, today it is an incredible honor that you've given to me to be your shepherd and your pastor, and I want to be that any way and every way that I can. Feel free to call on me anytime if you ever need me. And so today our church opens its arms and we receive you into our church fellowship. Now, everybody knows what protocol is here, so go ahead and give them a warm hillbilly wave and welcome into Rehoboth Baptist Church. And you all can be seated immediately following the service. Our membership coordinator is going to come and meet you right up here in front, get all of your information. I hope we've got enough paperwork here today to get all this done. But thank each of you for coming. But you can go ahead and be seated. That way you don't have to stand down front as we close out this service. It's been a good day to be in God's house. Yeah, somebody's got to do something here. I think we're going to start, I think I told you, we'll start a lap ministry, because that's where we're going to have to let somebody borrow your lap to have a seat in the church. So, wow, what a problem. What a problem for a church to be able to have in this day and time. God is good to this church.
He's good to this church, and I'm telling you, I've told you this before, and I will tell you this forever. What God is doing in our church, He's doing not because of me, in spite of me. Just as much a human as anybody else in the room, and I'm amazed to see what God is doing in our midst. Absolutely overwhelming. Patrick, I'm going to let you close this out.
Just before our benediction, I would like to remind you that we are almost, it's almost Easter time. And we have a series of Holy Week services beginning on Palm Sunday, April 24th, Good Friday on March. On March the 24th, and then Good Friday is March the 29th at 7 p.m., a very intimate time of worship. And then on Sunday morning, Easter Sunday morning, the 31st, there'll be two worship services. Be watching on the announcements and through ChurchCast for these times and these special services coming up. But mark them on your calendar now, Palm Sunday, Good Friday, and Easter. We hope to see each of you here and bring a friend. Our benediction this morning, let's read it together, number 6, 24 through 26. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. Amen. 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 The Lord bless you and keep you. Make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn His face toward you and give you peace. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and we will see you back next week.